day after Queen Anne Boleyn was beheaded on Tower Green, her lady-in-waiting was rowed up the River Thames towards the royal palace. The lady-in-waiting was Jane Seymour. She was to be King Henry's new wife. The dead queen's body was scarcely cold, but the next queen was on her way to be betrothed to a man who had banished one wife and beheaded another. There was a complete contrast between Henry's second and third wives. They were night and day, heaven and hell. Anne Boleyn was a dramatic brunette with smouldering black eyes and a spirit and temper to match. She was capable of arousing Henry to heights of passion and to fits of sputtering rage. Jane Seymour, in contrast, was fair, so fair that she was almost pallid. She had pale blue eyes, mousy blonde hair, and a little receding chin. And she was quiet, demure, submissive, the perfect little woman, the model Tudor wife. But can she really have been such a doormat? After all, she had helped engineer Anne Boleyn's downfall, and she'd stepped to her throne pretty coolly through her blood. In order to marry Anne, Henry had made himself the supreme head of the English Church in place of the Pope. Traditional Catholics were appalled by Henry's religious revolution, and Jane Seymour was among them. She had been lady-in-waiting to the deeply Catholic Catherine of Aragon, and she hoped that Henry too would return to the true faith. So as Henry began to flirt with Jane, traditionalists led by Sir Nicholas Carew were delighted, but they had a powerful enemy. Thomas Cromwell had his own agenda for radical religious reform. So, behind the scenes, he would always fight Jane's influence on his master. Henry wasn't taking Jane particularly seriously. He was grooming her to be a casual mistress, not a wedded wife. So he used his usual technique of seduction. He sent her a letter full of high-flown sentiments and a purse with money in payment for services which, no doubt he thought, would be quickly rendered. And Jane might have remained just that, one of Henry's many mistresses. But her response to his gift transformed her life and sealed the fate of her mistress, Anne Boleyn. She rejected the money and she handed the letter back unopened. And then she flung herself on her knees and addressed the king through his messenger.
I am a gentlewoman of good, honourable parents, without reproach, and I have no greater riches in the world than my honour, which I would not injure for 1,000 deaths. And if the king wishes to make me some present of money, I beg it might be when God enables me to make some honourable match.
It was a masterpiece of seduction, presented as virtuous refusal. For Henry, this was powerfully attractive. Jane had been coached by Nicholas Carew, who told her to play up her natural demureness to lure the king away from the stridently sexy Anne Boleyn. Manipulating Henry's affections was a dangerous game. But Carew had chosen the right moment and the right woman. Henry had been bowled over by Jane's performance. She'd offered herself to him as his wife, and he accepted her with enthusiasm. His behaviour towards her transformed accordingly. From having been the hardened seducer, he became the respectful suitor. He would only see her with a chaperone, So Jane, her brother, and her sister-in-law were moved into a secret apartment next to the king's. Meanwhile, as the king and his new wife-to-be were enacting this parade of virtue, Henry's old wife, Anne Boleyn, was being sent to her death on trumped-up charges of multiple adultery, incest, and perversion. 10 days after her execution, Henry and Jane were secretly married in the Queen's closet. Jane took as her motto, bound to obey and serve, but she never surrendered her distinctly Catholic faith. As soon as she became queen, Jane put her own stamp on the court. In particular, her ladies were expected to present themselves as models of virtue. They were advised to be sober, sad, wise, discreet and lowly, and above all things, obedient and willing to be governed. They were also banned from dressing in seductive French fashions, and instead had to wear traditional English dress. Jane's new style came as a blessed relief to the king and the court. "We have come from hell into heaven," remarked one of Henry's oldest friends. But the real question was whether England would now come to heaven in a new way. Religion was one of the areas where 16th century women had a certain freedom of action. Anne Boleyn had pushed that freedom to the limits and beyond in favour of religious reform. Jane Seymour's religious beliefs were as sincere as Anne's, but they were the opposite. She was a pious Catholic, not a radical reformer. But would Jane be as persuasive for her beliefs as Anne had been for hers? Henry had begun to reform the church for the love of his second wife. Would he undo what he had done, go back to Catholicism, perhaps even to Rome, for the love of his third? The first test of Jane's influence was in defence of the Princess Mary, daughter of Catherine of Aragon. Mary had been brought up a devout Catholic and under Anne Boleyn had been pronounced illegitimate. But Mary refused to acknowledge her demotion. And when the sympathetic Jane replaced the bitterly hostile Anne, Mary's supporters saw a chance to get her rehabilitated. Their leader, Nicholas Carew, urged Jane to approach Henry directly. But Jane was no mere instrument. She had a deep personal loyalty to Mary, and she made her cause her own. But there were real dangers in doing what Carew wanted. Even to name Mary as heir was treason. Henry's temper was notoriously unreliable, and Jane's own position was far from secure. Nevertheless, Jane was prepared to risk everything out of conscience and conviction. Jane begged her husband to restore Mary to the succession. Henry told her she was a fool. Instead, she should be begging for their children to be made heirs to the throne. But Jane stuck to her guns. Their children would only be safe if justice were done to Mary, and Mary was made heiress once more. Jane spoke, she said,
"I ask not for the good of others, but for the repose and tranquillity of the king, of the children we might have together, and of the kingdom in general."
But Jane was playing with fire. Henry was determined that Mary should surrender absolutely to his will. Suddenly, Mary's friends were summoned before the council and interrogated about their activities on her behalf. If Mary did not surrender, it was now clear, all of them, perhaps including Jane herself, faced charges of treason on grounds of illegally trying to change the succession. Fortunately for Jane, Mary, confronted with this terrible choice between the lives of her friends and her conscience, surrendered, acknowledged that her mother's marriage had been illegal and incestuous, and that she was a bastard. Jane's first serious intervention in politics had backfired horribly. It had been her hope that Mary's rehabilitation would mark the beginning of a Catholic restoration. Instead, Mary had acknowledged the basic principles of the Reformation. For the king's wife, as well as the king's daughter, absolute obedience, it seemed, was the only safe strategy. Jane had lost the first battle to restore Mary, and with her, the old religion. But she didn't give up. Whatever the risks, she would try again. It was the autumn of 1536. Jane had been queen for almost 6 months, but her Catholic followers were in despair. Her influence over Henry had not been as strong as Cromwell's. The dissolution of the monasteries had begun. Churches were being reduced to roofless ruins. Holy shrines and images were being smashed, and the relics of saints burned. Now, only direct action could halt the attack on the church. Catholic courtiers, like Carew, had too much at stake to dare to risk it. But in the countryside, men were bolder. In the autumn of 1536, a great revolt, known as the Pilgrimage of Grace, broke out. It started in Lincolnshire and soon engulfed the whole of the north of England. Nobles and peasants joined together and found a charismatic leader in Robert Aske. "Restore the monasteries and burn the heretics," was their cry. It was the greatest crisis of Henry's reign. The rebel forces were very strong, and even in the south, Henry couldn't trust the loyalty of his nobles. Jane faced a tremendous dilemma. Her sympathies were with the aims of the rebellion. Her duty was to her husband, the husband who she believed was sinning against God. Finally, she dared to question directly the king's religious policies. She remarked that perhaps God permitted the rebellion because the king had ruined so many churches. Henry reminded her that the last queen had died in consequence of meddling too much in state affairs. "Don't meddle with my affairs, and remember Anne Boleyn." Henry's words were an awful warning, which Jane, unlike Anne, had the good sense to accept. Nevertheless, her real opinions were common knowledge. So much so that at the height of the revolt, open negotiations took place in the Queen's chamber to get a nunnery exempted from the dissolution. The incident was investigated by the council, and it could easily have led to a charge of treason against Jane for supporting the rebels' demands. But the charges never came. Henry wasn't strong enough to defeat the rebels militarily. Instead, he had to negotiate. He summoned the rebel leaders and told them that Jane would accompany him on a tour of reconciliation to the north. She would even be crowned in York Minster as the north's own Catholic queen. The rebels were jubilant. Their faith in Queen Jane had been justified. That Christmas, there was peace and joy. The rebel leaders were invited as guests to court. The king and queen processed through the city and were blessed by the clergy. All the old Christmas traditions were kept. Jane was triumphant. She had helped to reconcile Henry with his subjects, and then she gave him something that he wanted even more. She was pregnant. Henry was transported with joy.
"Our dear and most entirely beloved wife, the Queen, now quick with child, for the which we give most humble thanks to Almighty God."
But even as he celebrated, Henry betrayed Jane. He had never intended to give in to the rebels. He has simply used their love of the Queen to help to pacify them. Now, he cancelled her tour of the North and her coronation. He ordered the arrest of the rebel leaders, and as the Te Deum was sung in celebration of Jane's pregnancy, their heads were spiked on Tower Bridge. On the 9th of October, Jane's labour pains began. They continued for 2 agonising days. By the 11th, there were real fears for the life of both the Queen and her child, and special prayers were offered up in London for their safety. Early the following morning, the efforts of the nurses and midwife were rewarded, and at 2 a.m., it was all over. The baby was a boy, a healthy baby boy. For the first time in almost 30 years of marriage to 3 different wives, Henry had an heir. Jane was now everything he could wish for. There was an outpouring of national rejoicing. God had smiled on England. The baby was a new John the Baptist. God himself was English. But most triumphant of all was Jane. She had given Henry his longed-for son and heir. Whatever she said or did now, she was secure. Whatever she asked for, Henry surely would grant.
Right trusty and well-beloved, we greet you well. By the inestimable goodness and grace of the Almighty, are we delivered and brought in childbed of a prince, conceived in most lawful matrimony between my lord the King's Majesty and us.
In nomine Patris et Filii.
The christening was a sumptuous affair. The Seymours and their allies, their position immeasurably strengthened by the birth of the prince, took pride of place. That same day, Jane suddenly became ill. She entered into a protracted delirium. The king's ministers blamed her attendants for allowing her to catch cold and eat strange food. In reality, it was puerperal fever. Her bruised and torn tissues had become infected. Soon, septicemia set in. The court prayed that she would be spared. Processions were made in London. In vain. On the 24th of October, 1537, the Queen died. Jane was the Queen who satisfied Henry best. She gave him a son, and she displayed a proper, wifely submission. But behind the submission were serious convictions and a real courage, if one that sensibly knew its limitations. Yet Jane's story, finally, is one of promise unfulfilled. Everybody had expected, and Jane herself had passionately hoped, that her marriage to Henry would have led to the restoration of real Catholicism in England. It hadn't happened. Would things have been different if Jane had lived? I doubt it, because Henry, it turned out, was even more wedded to the royal supremacy over the English church than he was to Jane. And not even for Jane, his true and best beloved wife, would he give it up. Jane had fought a battle for herself and for English Catholicism, and she'd lost. Henry was stricken with grief and withdrew from the court. Cromwell took affairs of state into his own hands. Now perhaps he could find Henry a wife. Perhaps she would be more sympathetic to his own religious ambitions. Perhaps he would find her abroad. He wrote to the English ambassadors in France, the happy news of the new prince, the tragic news of the death of the queen, and the interesting news that the king was in need of a new wife.